the song of the redeemed, rising from the African plain. It's the song of the forgiven, drowning out the Amazon rain. The song of Asian believers, filled with God's holy fire. It's every tribe, every tongue, every nation, a love song born of a grateful choir. It's all God's children singing glory, glory. Cathedrals to the faithful gathered underground. Of all the songs sung from the dawn of creation, some were meant to persist. Of all the bells rung from a thousand steeples, none rings truer than this.
Children singing glory. Session. Thank you all for coming and coming early and being a part. I'm David Graves. I have the privilege to be the district superintendent of the Kingsport District. I want to welcome you here as we kind of settle into our time. I know many of you travel from various places. I understand there's stories of people being stuck in traffic and trying to get here and all those kind of things. And we look forward to what God is going to do in and through us over the next few days. So let's begin with a word of prayer. God, our Heavenly Father, we come and we give you thanks for life that you give us that is so abundant. However, Lord, there are many people that walk this journey that don't experience the abundant life because they don't seek you. And as we come over the next hour and to share our story and to begin to move into this next 4 days, we're radically called to look at church differently. And in the time of this world that there is so much darkness, the church has the greatest opportunity to be such light. We hear stories that the church is declining, and it is. We hear stories of churches closing, and they are. But I believe, O Heavenly Father, that this is the greatest time to be the church because people are so open to good news. In the name of Jesus and all of God's people said, amen. It's a great privilege and an honor to be with Will Shewey and Barry Kidwell today. And we're talking about how can mainline denominations minister to those outside the bounds of our society. And we give thanks that we were asked to come and to share with you over the next little over an hour. And we hope that you are encouraged and challenged because the mainline church, friends, has been disconnected from our society. Because if we had not become disconnected, our churches would be overflowing with people because there's a great need for people to know and to come Jesus Christ, to know Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. Recently, I heard an individual who's a good friend of mine begin to talk about Matthew chapter 25 and Matthew chapter 28 and how we in the mainline church have kind of disconnected those two scriptures. In Matthew chapter 25, we do a lot for people. In Matthew chapter 28 is the Great Commission, right?
That we're to go and make disciples. However, ministry is more than just doing things for people, but it's doing things with people and it's building relationships. And when we do that with those outside the walls of our churches, it's very hard, it's very difficult, and it's very messy.
If you read Slaughter's book, and we were all called to do that, and if you write a report on it, you get extra credit or full credit for this event. And I'm yet to finish writing that, but he talks in the book that if you believe in Jesus, you got to follow Jesus. And following Jesus is very radical. And he goes back and forth and talks about how in the early church, going back to Jesus, he was considered to be a radical, was he not? And he pushed against society and he pushed against the church. And I believe in many cases we've lost our passion, we've lost our courage, we've lost our boldness. In the Kingsport District, I've encouraged our pastors to get into holy trouble. Don't just get into trouble. but get into holy trouble. Because if you're about getting into holy trouble, you're going to push the people in your congregations, and you're going to push the envelope in those communities that are around you. And we talk about connecting with our communities, but are we really going to go outside the walls of our communities and make a difference? When we think about Matthew chapter 25, verse 31, when the Son of Man comes in His glory, and all the angels with Him, then He will sit upon His glorious throne. And all the nations will be gathered in His presence, and He will separate the people as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. We know that scripture, do we not? He will place the sheep on His right hand and the goats on His left. And we know the story is that Jesus begins to talk about when the Master, the Lord, was hungry and you fed Him. He was thirsty and you gave drink. He was naked and you clothed. He was sick and you walked with Him. And when He was in prison, you visited Him. And people begin to say, Lord, when did we see You? And that scripture goes on to tell us that when You did it to the least of these, You did it unto Me. In verse 37, the righteous ones will reply, Lord, when did we ever see You hungry and feed You, or thirsty and give You drink, or a stranger and show You hospitality, or naked and gave You clothing? When did we ever see You sick or in prison and visit You? And that 40th verse, and the king will say, I will tell you the truth. When You did it to Me, You did it to one of the least of these, My brothers and sisters, You were doing it to Me. Now here's the part that we really need to take seriously. There is judgment. And there is eternal reward. I hope you believe that. Because Jesus said there is. Eternal punishment will come to those, but the righteous will go into eternal life. In the 28th verse, verse 18, Jesus came and told His disciples, I have given you all authority in heaven and on earth. Therefore, go and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, and teach these new disciples to obey all the commands I have given you. And be sure of this, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. That's why personally I've developed a personal mission statement. It's all about winning people to Jesus. It's all about seeing people that other people don't see, and it's about transforming lives, and it's about changing the world. And that's what gets me up and what gets me motivated. It's not about the copiers working or not working. It's not about the scouts that are tearing something up. I mean, somebody's got to deal with that, but it's got to be about winning people to Jesus. And I believe that's the question we need to be asking when we gather together. Are we winning people to Jesus, and is this going to help us win people? And are we seeing the people that other people don't see? Are we moving outside of our walls? Are we really making a difference? And friends, the day that you expect people to show up in your church at 11 o'clock is over. So the church must move beyond its walls and not just do ministry for people, but it must connect what Jesus said in Matthew chapter 25 and in Matthew chapter 28. It's doing ministry with people. It's walking alongside people. It's being in ministry together. And in many ways, we've disconnected those two scriptures. So think about that. And so as we come and begin to share just a little bit, I want to encourage you to get in some holy trouble. Not just trouble, but holy trouble. There's a difference there. As a denominational leader, as I talk to many people, and as a pastor in a local church, people are called to do ministry that is much different than the typical church today. And so how are we going to give people avenues and opportunities to fulfill their passion in the local church? And as we, as denominational leaders, how do we begin to open and create opportunities for people to fulfill their passion and call to ministry that they're not going to fit into a typical local congregation? Some of you may be here today, and one of these who is coming to share, Barry Kidwell, Mustard Seed Ministries out of Chattanooga, and I've known Barry for a long time, and he kind of felt a little bit entrapped in the local church, and while a lot of us were trying to stay warm, this man here was out making sure everybody was warm, living under bridges, and living behind buildings. And so Barry's going to come and share his ministry. Then Will Shewey is going to come and share about a new church start in his ministry. And then we're going to have a little dialogue together.
Thanks, David. We're Mustard Tree Ministries, and I started there about 10 years ago. Actually started at Forest Avenue Methodist Church, was assigned to go there. It was a church that was on the decline in downtown Chattanooga, and kind of in downtown Chattanooga. And, you know, and what David's talking about is like opening up the church and expecting people to walk in at 11 o'clock. You may still have that in some suburban areas, yeah, but I doubt it's really that many. But, you know, I understand what he's talking about, because when I first went to Forest Avenue and got there the very first Sunday that I was appointed there, the lay leader, there was only, honestly, 15 people in the church. The lay leader of the church, after, you know, a little bit, as we were about to start the Sunday morning worship, he went around to all the doors and started locking them. And I said, "What are you doing?" He said, "We're afraid somebody might walk in off the streets." I kind of scratched my head and went, "No wonder you have 15 people here on Sunday morning." The area at that time of North Chattanooga, which has totally changed, there's a street there called Tremont Street, and the thing that people said about the people that lived on Tremont Street, they called them tree monsters. And some of the folks that are still kind of residual from there, their thing was is that the people that live in this neighborhood, they either just got out of jail or they're on their way to jail. And so that's why the folks at Forest Avenue locked the door. And I said, "Well, we're going to leave it unlocked because I've invited 20 people to come here that I know that are coming." They said, "How do you know they're coming?" I said, "Because they promised me they were coming." "Well, where are they coming from?" And I said, "You probably don't want to know. And especially if you're locking the doors." And so when they came, they immediately called my district superintendent at the time and asked to have a meeting with him, because I was just there one Sunday and they wanted me moved. And, you know, it's kind of weird because, you know, they said they wanted to be a missional church, but they forgot what mission meant. And as I was thinking about, you know, what to say today, I got here and noticed that you get this little booklet and it's got notes in it that some of these other guys that are doing these other workshops put together. And I said, you know, it probably would help if I would have ever come to a minister's convocation before this one. I might have known that I could have put notes in the book for you. I've been in ministry 35 years, never been to a minister's convocation. And I told a friend of mine, I said, "I'm glad it's the season of Lent. Now I can fast for the next 40 days of preachers." So, you know, just that's the truth. I have a whole lot of friends out on the street, and that's where I like to be. It's like David said, I always felt trapped. I told Nathan Malone once when we were at the end of a district meeting, and Nathan may remember this. I came to him after we had talked about this call thing, and I said, you know, if I'd have really understood when I became a Christian, I said, I'd probably never become a local pastor. I said, because when I became a Christian, it was out of a rough kind of lifestyle, and I thought that's the kind of people that the church has reached. And then, you know, I got in those places where that's not where folks wanted them. And I began to realize that, you know, if we really want to do ministry outside the bounds of society or reach the unchurched or whatever we want to call it, we begin to have to, again, realize that our call is to the people that need us the most, kind of like what William Booth said when he started the Salvation Army. And, you know, to go and be that. And, you know, I have some heroes of, you know, the faith that really kind of guided me, or even though they were dead, they still kind of guided me in my journey. And one was William Wilberforce. Do y'all know who he was? And the other was Dietrich Bonhoeffer. I know everybody knows who he was. And out of looking at the things that they did as I was becoming a Christian, that's kind of where I said I wanted to be with my life. I wanted to be somebody who challenged the church and challenged folks to once again embrace the fact that we can't just be religious. We have to truly be Christian. And I think that just as both of them said, that too often we become religious. And Bonhoeffer, or, you know, it was Wilberforce even said that we have to quit discussing theology and just go do ministry. And I think that sometimes that's what we do. We'll have debates, we'll have discussions, even probably at the clergy thing, about theology, the theology of whatever the hot topic is now. And that's okay. But I found in my own life that if you just go out there and meet people, they really don't care what your theology is, as long as your theology is that of love. You know, I know one of the topics we'll debate and is going to be on homosexuality. And I've got a lesbian couple coming to the church that I pastor. And the only reason they come is because they know I love them. Because in the other churches they've been to, they've been told they aren't welcome because of the lifestyle they live. And they live on the street. And they've asked me, you know, what I think about it. And I tell them, you know, that you have to in your life, you have to seek God. And you have to look to God. And you have to come to grips with what God says. I said, it doesn't matter how I judge you. I said, I'm not called to judge. I'm called to love. And I said, I just want y'all to know I love you like you are. And so they come. And they participate. And they know that they have a safe place to come. And that's what we have to do, is we have to create safe places where people can come and explore the faith again. You know, where they can come and know that they're loved no matter what they've done or what they're doing. And that's what we've tried to do. We reach all sorts of folks, and we reach them in different ways. You know, when we first started this ministry, and there's a young lady, David Hall has had her in his classes, and she's become a licensed local pastor, not a licensed local pastor, a local certified lay minister. I knew she was something. She teaches Bible studies and stuff for me. When I first met her and her husband now on the street, they live together under the Broad Street Bridge in Chattanooga. Both of them addicted to crack cocaine. Both of them involved in all kinds of stuff. They started coming just to a ministry that we have where we have food for people that are hungry to come. They didn't stay for church or Bible study. They just came to eat. And as we developed a relationship, and as I would take them firewood in the winter and sterno to keep their tent warm and stuff like that, they started coming to Bible study. And our Bible study was in the basement, and they felt comfortable coming into the basement. They didn't feel comfortable coming into the sanctuary. Then one Wednesday night, they said, we want to come to church Sunday morning. And I said, okay, you can come. And so they came to church Sunday morning, and they sat in the sanctuary. And they asked me when they came in, where do we have to sit? And I said, you can sit anywhere you want. And she said, well, a lot of churches around here, when we go, they have assigned seats for people like us. And I said, yeah, we do too, wherever you want. And so they sat and became a part of the congregation. And then as time went on, they came and talked to me and asked me if I would baptize them. And I said, yeah, I'll be glad to. I'll be glad to receive you by profession of faith in Jesus Christ. And so as we began to talk, Angel is the girl's name. Angel said, well, she said, there's something you got to know about me. And I was like, well, okay, Angel, what is it? And I said, you know, I know pretty much about you. She had cold turkey rehabbed off cocaine. She and her husband both. They didn't go to rehab. They did that cold turkey living on the streets. That's hard. That's how serious they were about redirecting their life and finding life in Jesus Christ. And I knew that. I went through all that with them. And so she knew I knew she was a crack addict. But then as we were in our discussion, she said to me, she said, before you baptize me, I've got to confess one thing to you. And I said, well, Angel, what's that? She said, you know, I'm a prostitute. No, she said, I'm a prostitute. And I said, Angel, I know that. And she said, how do you know I'm a prostitute? I said, I'm out on the streets all the time. I know what you're doing. And she said, and you still love me? I said, yeah, I don't love you for what you are. I love you for what you can become. And I love you for who you are. And she hugged me and she said, "You're the first male that has ever showed me love without there being any kind of sex involved." And that transformed her life. See, that's why I say we accept people no matter what their lifestyle is. Because we know that they'll never have the opportunity to change if we just don't love them like they are. And accept them where they are. And help them to let Christ form in them the life that He wants them to live. I think, you know, as we talk about theology, because we do, if you really want to talk about theology, you can talk about the I think the greatest theology there is, and that's the incarnational theology. But I think we talk about it instead of living it. Because that's the only way you're going to reach folks outside of where, you know, the walls of your church is if we really become incarnate. And we really go out to where people are. And we really become, you know, just walk on the streets or walk wherever they walk. See, in our ministry, we don't just minister to homeless folks. I go into the projects. I go into the West Side Projects, East Lake Courts. I was in East Lake Courts last night with a kid who's a part of our ministry who used to lead one of the gangs in East Lake Courts. And as he was getting out of my van, he saw a little medallion that I had hanging off of the rearview mirror of my van. And he looked at that and he said, "If you ever decide to get rid of that, can I have it?" And I said, "Kennedy, why do you want it?" He said, "Because it will identify me as a Christian now." He said, "I've identified myself for a long time as a Skyline Blood." He said, "This will identify me as a follower of Jesus Christ." I took it off my rearview mirror and I said, "Here you go." He said, "Where'd you get that?" I said, "A friend of mine brought it back to me from Israel, but don't worry about it. He'll go again and he can bring me another one." But he was proud of that because now his identity is not with the Bloods or the Crips or the M13s or whatever. His identity is in Jesus Christ, and he wants the people around him to know that. How would he have ever known if some of us hadn't have gone and ministered on the street corner where he was slinging dope? Because that's what he did when he started coming to our church. His occupation was selling drugs. When he came, we didn't say, "You got to quit selling drugs before you can come here." We said, "Come on in. Come on in and worship with us." And, you know, it was only about 2 months ago that I baptized him. And the only thing about him is that, Doug, someday you got to get the baptistry in there where you dunk people. Because he keeps telling me, my mom and daddy were Baptists, and I've got to be dunked. That sprinkling stuff just don't work for me. And so someday we're going to dunk him on a Sunday night at First Centenary. But until then, you know, he's okay with the fact that we sprinkled each other. But again, you know, the things that I think about is, we've got to stop being religious and be Christian and understand what that means. And we've got to, in our lives, we've got to, doing that, take just the next step sometimes. You know, think about, you know, in the ministry where I've been, you know, just taking that next step. And you don't always know what it's going to be. You know, we had Forest Avenue Church, and then it got closed down, and then we worshiped under a bridge for about 2 years. And I didn't always know what the next step was going to be in that. I just knew we just kept gathering under the bridge, and we kept breaking bread, and we kept going out on the streets and taking things that people needed on the streets, and we kept going to the projects, and we kept doing those things until actually First Baptist Church opened up a room for us to use, and then First Centenary. And we don't know yet what our next step's going to be. But I just know this, that there's going to be a next step. But we can't ever leave the steps that we began with. And that is the going out on the streets. That is the going to the places where folks are. Going to the streets where I go to the streets where the prostitutes walk. I go to the places where they sell cocaine. I go to the, you know, and that's not for everybody. And I understand that. And that's why I also say that to folks that where on Signal Mountain where I do some ministry on the weekends, kind of, there's people everywhere that don't go to church. But if you don't go to where they are and invite them to come to where you are, they won't ever come. Jesus called us to be salt and light wherever we were. He called us to make a difference in all kinds of situations. And for me, again, I think that the most important theology, John 1:1, even though Matthew is my favorite gospel, John 1:1, or John chapter 1, is the thing that I think that we have to live by. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. He didn't sit in an office and say, God, what do we do for those people out there? He left his office. See, I used to get in trouble all the time at St. John after Randy Martin left. Because we had, I know you did, but you left. We had a secretary there that whenever I would leave the building, she'd say, where are you going? And I'd say, I don't know. And she'd say, how can you say you don't know? I said, well, I may end up at Harriet Tubman Projects, or I may end up at the community kitchen, or I may end up, she said, well, what if somebody comes by here looking for you? I said, tell them I'll be here Sunday morning. It used to drive her crazy. And she asked me for my cell phone number, and I said, that's just for my wife and kids. She finally got it from my wife, and she'd call me from time to time and just say, when are you coming back to the office? And I'd go, I don't know, because I can't do ministry in the office. I can't, you know, I can read my Bible when I get home tonight. I can pray as I'm walking. I can do that, but to do ministry, I got to be out here where the folks are. And that's just what I encourage anybody that's in here, is that you got to get out to where the folks are that are lost. No matter what walk of life they're in, whether they're selling drugs, living in prostitution, or living together as cohabitating as whatever, you got to get out to where the lost people are so that they can see Christ and come into the church again and experience Christ. You know, one of the things that I found is that too often I have to, before I can even introduce somebody to Jesus, I have to get them to like the church again. And the only way to get folks to like the church again is to do things differently than we've done. Because we've been far too judgmental. And we've not been enough loving. And just one of the things that what William Wilberforce said, I lost my glasses. I can't read it to you. One of the things William Wilberforce said was that we have one dictate from God. And he said, it's how loving we are. And have we forgotten that? And he said that the Church of England had forgotten what the love of God and the love of fellow man was all about. And he said, until the church recaptured that, that the church would never be the church again. And so, you know, as you think about going outside the walls of the church to minister to the folks on the outside, that's what you got to go with. A passion for God and a passion for the people. And if you don't have a passion for them, they can see through you and they won't come. So go with a loving heart and know that that love can conquer. It's like the Bible said, a multitude of sins. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, Barry, and welcome to your first minister's convocation, by the way. I hope you heard the power of connection in what he shared, because many people from many various churches, United Methodist churches, you're also ecumenical and Baptist, have helped you in your ministry. You heard that David Hall from Christ United Methodist Church has helped teach leaders. First Centenary has given up space and time. And so it takes all of us working together. And there's the beauty of that. You mentioned one thing that that also goes along with what Mike Slaughter wrote in his book. He shares that Christians have done more to destroy the image and message of Jesus than all the atheists and agnostics combined. That's a pretty strong statement, and I'm sure we'll hear more about that. But you've experienced that. Thank you so much. About this time last year, Will Shewey, who was serving a church in the Kingsport District and serving it very well, came to me and said, you know, David, I feel God is calling me to start a storefront congregation to reach and out to the least, the last, and the lost. And he's added another word. I'll let him use that in just a few moments. He shared with me that he really didn't want to go into another traditional church, but he felt God was leading and calling. And so in our district, we have a district strategy and plan, and we begin to talk about that. And so Bishop Taylor and Rusty are in the room, and so I went and kind of began to cast that vision. And Rusty, as director of congregational development, came, and we began to explore that, and they allocated some funding for that. A little over $50,000, and then Bishop Taylor appointed Will at July 1st as just a pastor for a new church start. Had no location, no people, basically appointed him to the streets. And so here we are a few months later, and I'm going to let you, Will, tell the story around a church. You know, a lot of talk today is shades of gray, right? And Will is the pastor of Shades of Grace. So, Will, you come and share.
Okay, thank you. There's so much to say, and it's exciting to be a part of this ministry. Before I share a little more, I think we hopefully have a DVD that you can watch, and this will give you an idea of some of the things that go on at Shades of Grace, and then I'll talk a little more about it. Okay, it's about 6 minutes or so.
With temperatures dipping into single digits tonight, some people who are normally out in the elements will be looking for a warm place to stay.
Yeah, and that's where local churches come in, offering help and a warm place to stay. News 5 WCYB's Kyle Benjamin joins us now in the studio. Hey, Kyle, you actually went to a church in Kingsport today.
Yeah, Julie, I did. And what started as a temporary solution for people in need quickly morphed into something much bigger, thanks in part to the generosity of strangers and a congregation who knows what it's like to be on the streets. Shades of Grace United Methodist Church opened its doors for the first time this fall. Pastor Will Shewey says most of his congregation is transient.
We discovered there are a lot of people who are sleeping in, under bridges and alleyways and have no homes.
That got the wheels turning. Shewey decided he needed to do something to help while it's so cold.
We're not a shelter. We're not a night shelter, but due to the circumstances of this weather, we are going to keep the church open.
That means hot meals, warm drinks, and a place out of the elements.
There's been a few times where I've reached for a place like this.
Julia Bishop used to live on the street, and on Wednesday, she was at her church, making others feel welcome. Over the next few days, Pastor Shewey says he expects a crowd.
As the temperatures drop, more people will come. We're going to have hot meals available here day and night until the cold weather leaves.
Now, Pastor Will told me he originally planned to just kind of keep the church open until 5 o'clock today, but enough people volunteered to stay overnight. Others brought food and blankets. While I was there, one couple actually drove down from Hawkins County just to give the church a little bit of money to help out, Julie.
It's all about helping each other. Thanks so much.
Sometimes you feel so far away, but I know my walk with you is all I faith. All I want to do is praise your name and see your holy face. This holy ground we call Shades of Grace has become a blessed, sacred meeting place, where at least lost that's known me, I'm so open in life's crazy race. Oh, Holy One of Israel, raise our hands to glorify your name. Cause it's all about Jesus' name. You alone desire to hear our praise. This holy ground we call Shades of Grace has become a blessed, sacred meeting place, where the least thoughts last lonely find some hope in life's crazy. Oh Lord, our blessed Savior, you're the only thing in life that does not change. So why not take a chance on him? Lead him on the council to bow and pray. This holy ground we call Shades of Grace has become a blessed, sacred.
Thank you. I guess that's it. Most of the people that you see doing music are homeless. They're people from the streets. Some of them are veterans who are in a veterans program at the VA hospital and working with Salvation Army to have a place to stay. But there's so much talent among the people who live on the streets, and the people whom we know as the least, last, lost, and lonely. And so we began the ministry the last Sunday in July at Mayfair United Methodist Church. They graciously permitted us to use their building for 3 months. And during that time, we gathered a nucleus of people together of about 60 or 70 people who have the same vision and burden that I do for this kind of ministry, because as Barry and David said, it's not for everybody. It's not the kind of church that probably some of you would be comfortable with. Other of you may love to do it. It's just whatever God calls us to do. And we're all uniquely called in different ways to serve in the kingdom of God. But we waited there for 3 months, but we knew that our real mission was downtown. And so a building was located, and we began there the latter part of October. And immediately we jumped from about 72, I believe, I don't know my statistics exactly, while we were at Mayfair until about 112 the first Sunday that we moved, because so many of the homeless people began coming. And it's a process of a fellowship and making relationships in the community. We started, before we actually opened the church, by actually going to a parking lot near the church, a public parking area, and serving hot dogs on Wednesday evenings. And we began to tell folks that, see that building over there? We're going to have a church. So they became our best proponents of that ministry, and they really began, we gained their trust. It took a while because we were looked upon with suspicion, but I actually received a great compliment last week from the major at the Salvation Army, who said, we can really see some major changes in the personalities of some of the people we've known a long time on the streets, that Shades of Grace is truly making a difference and lives are being transformed. And that's really what it's all about. Serving on the transformational team the past 6 years, the one thing that we keep ever before us is that we're in the business of transforming lives, or that Jesus Christ transforms lives, but we reach out to those who are left behind and looked over maybe in many other ways in life. So we created, or are trying to create, a DNA in this congregation that everybody is equal. We're not there in ministry to, quote, those people, unquote, but we are there to be in ministry together with one another. And I try to tell the folk, this is your church. Take ownership of it. This is your church. We have one homeless man who's lived homeless for a long, long time, and every month he comes to me, and he'll have a $10 bill discreetly folded in the palm of his hand and walk by and just, and thank you, Pastor, for what you're doing now. Can you help somebody else with this? And that's the heart of the people. Sometimes those who have the least give the most, and Jesus taught that in so many ways. But anyway, the ministry is great. You saw some of the baptisms that we performed during the season of Advent. We're blessed to baptize 5 people, 4 of whom were street people living under bridges, but who one of them recently just got out of jail. One thing about our congregation, Barry, is exactly right. Either they're headed to jail or they're just getting out. Right. I mean, that is absolutely the truth. Saturday evening of this past week, 2 days ago, I spent the afternoon in the building with a young man who's been married exactly a year today. They have a little baby, and he waited there in the church office to surrender himself to the authorities for an outstanding charge. And so this happens all the time. We kept the church open the past 8 days as an emergency shelter, and many miracles take place during that time. Yes, and we worship at 4 p.m., on Sundays. We're not a Sunday morning church. I always try to get there early. I spend about 8 hours every Sunday anyway, 8 or 9 hours. But I got there early yesterday, knowing that our building was filled with people seeking refuge from the storm. And down the street, there's a little cafe just 2 doors down, Two Dads Cafe. Some of you know it. And under the balcony, under their canopy, I saw a familiar figure, and she was actually, I won't tell you which one, but she was actually in the DVD. She was there, the lady. She's a middle-aged lady. And she was huddling under a blanket and all just crumpled on the ground over there. And I walked over, and I realized very quickly she had been brutally raped and beaten very severely the night before, just a few blocks away from the church. And she had come to the place that she trusts. She trusted Pastor Will, and she trusted her friends at Shades of Grace. We were able to get her into the church. I took her again into my office space and asked her to please sit as some other people assisted her. And she immediately just got down into the floor. I said, no, please sit on the sofa. But so many people are so beaten down by life, they feel not even worthy to sit on someone's sofa. They feel that they must always be, they've been put down so much. But she was so hesitant for me to call the authorities, and I said, I have to. And she knew who the perpetrator was, and she didn't want to go to the hospital. She finally admitted, I have marijuana in my system, and I'm afraid they'll lock me up. It turns out she had a broken nose, a brain concussion, bruises, black eye, and all kinds of cuts in her head and in her body. And one of our faithful members, Judy, at Shades of Grace, stayed all day at the hospital with her yesterday. And so these are kinds of things that we deal with on a daily basis, and I could literally tell you story upon story upon story of what God has done and how lives are being transformed in Shades of Grace, a United Methodist congregation. But I always believe and have preached for many years that where God guides, God always provides. How many of you believe that? We know it's true, right? And so we believe, and David knows this. Can I go ahead and tell him that? By annual conference, with the help of $50,000 from the Holston Conference to subsidize my salary, we will be 100% self-sustaining at annual conference this year to be able to do everything that we need to do in ministry. And how can that happen when half of your congregation is homeless and have very little to nothing? But let me just give you an example. You'll have to tell me when to stop. So, and he does. I promise you, he'll tell me when to stop. So that's okay. He's done it before. But how God provides. Just go back with me 1 month, 4 weeks ago. I received a check. We had to do major work in the building. It ended up costing about $28,000, but our landlady paid $20,000, and we incurred about an $8,000 cost because we're putting in a shower for men, and we're also adding fixtures into the two existing bathrooms that we have. But it's an old, old building, and the pipes were just totally, almost 100 years. We couldn't do a stent. We had to do a complete bypass, really. So the whole building was completely dug up with a trench, and we were out of the building for 18 days. And we met at Mayfair once again, but how did we miss our people? How did we stay connected? We still came and fed them pizza on the street every Wednesday, every Saturday, and every Sunday. And those are the 3 days we do regular meals at the church. But during that time, when we were unable to occupy our church, I thought, you know, and Jim Goddard was there, and we were discussing, and we said, you know, the people are leaving today that are doing the construction, and if we're going to put a shower facility in, you know, it's going to cost a whole lot more and a bigger mess in the future. So just to put a place from here to you was $3,000 just to dig that trench in the cement. So we told the guy, go ahead and do it. I walked around the corner to the district office, and Susan handed me an envelope, and I opened it up, and would anybody want to guess what's in the envelope? $5,000. Exceedingly abundantly above and beyond what we could hope or expect. So that was evidence that God wanted us to do this. And so then we were going to have to, you know, we wanted to add the restroom extra fixtures in there. And the very next week, someone called me from my congregation, and they said, can you meet us at McDonald's? And I said, yeah. And they said, we want to give this to our church. And it was a check for $5,000. And they said, this is strictly to feed and house any of our people who are in need. The third week came by, and guess what? I received another check in the mail. Guess what? $5,000. Some of these are persons who have never attended Shades of Grace. Some have been there three or four times. The fourth week, taking us up to the past week before this last one, I went to the mailbox, and there was a check for $1,500 and another check for $1,000 and another two more checks for $500. So God is providing us in so many ways. After we have paid probably at least $20,000 in renovation to the building, not including what I just told you about, but putting cabinets in, fixtures, closing in the upstairs for rooms, doing some electrical work and other things, we have paid out at least, you know, $20,000 and more. All of our Everything is paid completely in full. They pay my housing. They pay my pension. They pay everything that goes along with any other Methodist pastor. And we still have probably at this point $25,000 to $30,000 in the bank at this time. And we were just able to purchase a brand new sound system for the church, about a $15,000 sound system that's being installed today as I speak. So we're there for the long haul. We pay $1,400 a month rent for the building. And God has just been gracious. We have given to missions. We've given money everywhere we can think to give money. And we just have trouble giving it all away, to be honest. Seriously, the more we give, the more God gives back to us. Shaken down, pressed together, running over. And that is the God we serve. And that is the God that we have a sign hanging a banner in the window of the church. It says, and you've heard the Chris Tomlin song, God of the City. And it's a banner that one of our members had designed and ordered it. And it says, God of the City. And that's what we have on the window. But it's wonderful what God has done, what God is doing. And, you know, we have many friends there. We love these people. And it's just a great place to be, to serve Jesus and to love the Lord. And God is just pouring out his blessings upon us. It's probably the most difficult ministry that I have ever participated in. I'll take away the word probably. It is. Absolutely, without doubt, the most difficult kind of work, and you can attest to that. Because of the emotional struggles and the conflict that goes on with seeing people in trouble. Last week, as people stayed in our church for eight days and nights, we had two families there who had one-year-old children who were homeless. They'd been living in their car, had nowhere to go. And they stayed all week. And they were there for worship yesterday. By the way, did I tell you yesterday we had 211 people in worship at Shades of Grace? By far, our greatest number in attendance on a day when most people were still snowed in, couldn't get out of their parking lots, and still we had a great day in the Lord. Thankful to another congregation, a United Methodist Church, who brought their youth group and served the afternoon meal and stayed for worship. But when we got ready to leave, and you come to Shades of Grace, you walk in the door, there's bicycles everywhere parked. There are backpacks, black garbage bags. I mean, you know that, right? I mean, that's part of our congregation. So when you come in, it's just a different atmosphere. It's a different place. It's not like most churches. But one of our worship leaders, Justin, wrote a song, and he calls it, he said, there's no other place that I could see that's more like God's living room than Shades of Grace. And we open the door and the people do come. You cannot be there 5 minutes without people walking in the building. And we've led people to the Lord just walking in off the street, giving them a hot cup of coffee or food. I never look at that scripture in the book of Acts the same anymore. When Peter and John went into the temple and they passed the man, and you know the story very well, silver and gold have I none, but what I do have I give in the name of Jesus. And we've learned very quickly that we cannot give silver and gold. Under any circumstances, we do not give cash at all. However, I wanted to finish the story from yesterday. The family, one of the families with the little one-year-old, a lady came for the first time. She and her husband had come to eat the meals we were serving this week. He was hobbling on a walker. They were in their 70s, and they live back behind a few blocks behind the church. And they came through the deep snow and struggled to get there to eat several days, and I began to talk to them. After worship, she came to me, and she said, Pastor Will, she said, they're going to turn my electricity off this week. We've been sick. We have a very limited income, and we've gotten behind in our bill. But what I had found out before, the young couple with the little boy had been invited to go home with this elderly couple. They said, you know, you can come and stay with us, even though our heat's going to be turned off. So this morning as I was driving, I called Susan at the office and at the district office, who's handling all of our finances, to please make arrangement that their electric is paid so that this family and the strangers in the land the least, last, lost, and lonely have a place to stay, even though the church. I told him yesterday in worship, we now shut down the shelter and we return to a normal church, whatever normal means for us. It means something different every week, to be honest. But it's a great pleasure to be a part of that ministry. And am I ready? Are you ready to kick me to stop?
We're getting ready to do something different. Go ahead. Why don't you all come and join me? Let's all come together here.
Well, two things about Shades of Grace. One, I remember being there on a Sunday afternoon at 4 o'clock, and I remember this really touched me and broke my heart. And this young man who'd been through a very difficult time stood up in the end of a worship service and said, "I want to thank you for treating us like people."
Yeah.
And then share the story about there was a homeless couple, came there, you all helped them find jobs, and they came through the doors this week, and they were bringing food.
Gosh, that could be a whole bunch of people.
Yeah.
I'm not sure which one it is. Let's see.
It's that couple you all helped find a job, and so they came back in this week with food to help feed those.
I have information overload in the brain. There's been too much going on this week. I don't know. I'm going to have to think about it. I just can't remember.
All right. Let me kind of remind you about it.
Y'all know what that means, right?
Yeah. I mean, because there's millions of stories.
Yeah.
But this couple were homeless. They came to Shades of Grace. They found God's love there, like you were talking about, Barry. They gave their lives to the Lord. You all helped them because you all set up some assistance to help people find jobs. Shades of Grace is now going to be the school system is partnering with you all to help people get their GEDs. You're helping people get in homes. Mm-hmm. And you all helped this couple find a job. I mean, you all are collecting white shirts and shoes for people are waitress and waitresses in places, and you know you're helping them not only just get something there, but also to better their lives. And so they had been helped in the first storm, but in the second storm they came to help.
Right. That's good.
Brenda and JT.
Yeah.
Brenda and JT.
Yeah.
Yeah. And so that's transformation. And that's why we do what we do.
And they still live on the streets right now, but they're working and saving their money and putting it together. And they said, we're working on getting a place to live this week. So they've been living with friends and wherever, but working and saving their money.
Right.
So.
And Barry, you might want to say just a word about your associate down here.
Oh, yeah. I brought my associate pastor with me today. His name's Zach, and he's right here on the front row. Zach, can you wave at everybody? Can you wave at everybody? Yeah. my son Zach is—he's autistic, and he's 24 years old, and he is my associate pastor. He goes out on the streets with me, and just like what Will's saying, everybody, except a few now, we have some volunteers that aren't homeless that come and help us. But everybody that goes out on the street with me used to be homeless or something like that. We serve like y'all do 3-4 meals a week. We go out on the street, take soup and sandwiches, stuff like that. We have people come to First Baptist, First Centenary, and we serve meals at those services. And twice a week, we take a hot soup out one day and just sandwiches out another day. And Zach always goes with me. And the thing about it with him is that he hugs everybody, and he doesn't see that there's a difference in any person, no matter who you are. He hugs everybody. And I can one of the fellows that was in our church, he actually used to volunteer with us. He died of lung cancer, but he became a Christian because of my son Zach, because he had grown up in a church and a very very not a very loving church, and his dad was the preacher. And he quit church, swore he'd never go back to church. And he began to meet us on the street. And Zach would go out with me. And he would watch how Zach and I related to each other. And I got two other kids to go out with me, too. But he goes out the most. And Zach would actually come up and sit next to him at all of our meals. And he would sit right there. The guy's name was Ron Johnston. He'd sit next to Ron the whole time. He'd always come and sit next to Ron. You know why? I don't know. God knows why. And then Ron started bringing him chewing gum. Now Ron's a homeless guy, and he'd bring Zach chewing gum, and he asked me before he gave it to him if he could, and I said, yeah, sure. And I remember the first time that Zach hugged Ron, or that actually Ron let Zach hug him, and tears just streaming down Ron's eyes, you know, just streaming down his cheeks, because he had, that feeling of not being loved. Just, you know, that hardness of his heart, you could just see it melt away. And it's just been wonderful for me to see those things happen to people, because they come into you, they come in with hard faces. They come in with, and when that does happen, you can see the transformation.
We've had those persons come and later say, it's been years since another person touched me or hugged me. Mm-hmm. And they, you know, it's just warms your heart.
And just see the transformation in their face. Just, you know, the hardness of their face go away. Yeah. And just the light of Christ shining through. So Zach and I, one of the things we will do, and we'll, if you want a hug before you leave today, just stand at the door. We'll hug you. Because we have learned that hugs melt hearts. So, if nothing else. Hug the folks that, I know the sexual ethics stuff that we talk about. I apologize. I probably flunk. But I hug everybody, you know. I hug everybody. And that's all right. I flunked a lot of things in preacher school, and that's okay. I made a D in evangelism in seminary. Yeah, go me. Yeah, only D I've ever made in my life, and I made a D in evangelism in seminary, and it's because I used to tell my professor, I don't care what DT Niles or anybody else said, I care about the people that are lost, and it ain't going to do me no good learning this other stuff, and and since the first of the year, we baptized 11 people, professions of faith in Jesus Christ. And that comes from a D. So if you guys that made A's in evangelism, y'all ought to be able to do in a whole lot more than that.
Amen. That's good, man.
As my son would say, a D, you pass. You know, you get by. You get
by.
That's
right, yeah.
But what a beautiful story, example that you and Zach get to do ministry together.
Yeah.
And friends, there is a place for all of God's people in this world and to be in ministry together. We want to take just a moment of our time to ask if you have questions that you want to ask any of us. But as you're thinking about that, just remember, what if you weren't allowed to do what you have done? What if we'd have kept you? I know what you'd have done. Mm-hmm. But what if?
I told you what I'd do.
Yeah, you did.
I told Al Bowles the same thing.
Yeah. And so just think, what if? And there are so many gifted people in our congregations that God is calling, and they have a passion on their heart, and ministry is much different. And how are we going to open doors and give opportunities for those kind of things to happen? Because you can see when you do what happens, right? What questions do you have that you might want to ask any of us? Anybody? We got one somewhere? Okay. Will, you have any? Yes, right over here.
I'd like to make a statement rather than ask a question. I'm just one big gob of gooey post nasal drip after what you guys have shared. And in my heart, I want to really pray for you and to lift up what you all are doing and what the Church of Jesus Christ is doing. And could we together, brothers and sisters, just extend a hand toward Will and toward Barry, toward David, toward what they're doing? Because it is representative, I think, of all of our hearts.
Amen. And let's do that when we conclude our time. That'd be good?
Okay.
But thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you.
The brutal attacker and rapist, was he homeless also?
He was not a homeless person. He was apprehended within 40 minutes and taken to jail. Yeah, thankfully. Yeah.
Any other question? Yes, right here. And then I'll come back over here. Yeah, repeat the question, Barry.
She asked, you know, folks that aren't in the storefront, homeless setting, how can they
downtown.
get their downtown, how can they get their folks to do ministry, stuff like that. Hugh Bryan and I were talking. Hugh serves in Meigs County where I started. And I just to say this, when I was in Meigs County, ministered to a fellow who lived in the trailer parks. And first day that I was on the streets of Chattanooga, I hear my name being hollered in downtown Chattanooga. Barry, Barry, Barry. And I'm like, who in the world knows me down here, you know? And I turn around, here's this guy that's got the Duck Dynasty beard before it was popular. And, he comes up to me and he says, you don't recognize me, do you? And I said, I don't, I'm sorry. He said, you used to visit my parents when they were in jail in Meigs County, and you used to help me. He was 15 years old when his parents were going to jail in Meigs County. And he said, you used to bring me to your house and feed me and stuff like that. And then I knew who it was. His name's Bill Hauser. And I also remember my wife was a teacher in Meigs County. And she brought a lot of kids home to our house. We've got three biological kids and like 1,000 other kids. And because of my wife. She would say, the teachers would talk about him. Oh, he's one of those Hauser boys. And I told people when I go to rural places and stuff, you know how you can help me and Will in your ministry? Minister to those folks because they're outcasts of society. Mm-hmm. Bill, at 15 years old, was an outcast of society already because of his parents. And nobody loved him. And, you know, how do you get your folks to do stuff like that? That's probably the hardest question in the world because the person has to have a change of heart. Everybody who does ministry and I think that we as preachers have to challenge folks. Amen. I'm like Will. I see God replacing, you know, people from Forest Avenue left because of the people we were reaching, but God sent other people. And I'm like you. I mean, a neighbor across the street from us at Forest Avenue was the president of EMJ Construction, and he got on to me for bringing homeless people into his community. And I said, let me just go for a walk with you. He's a Church of God Christian, I guess. But I'm just kidding. I went to Lee, so I know he's Christian. I took him for a walk. And he lived in a $1 million condominium. And I showed him just 100 yards from where his condominium was, where a homeless person was camping. I said, I'm not bringing them into your neighborhood. They're already here. You're just not wanting to see them. Mm-hmm. And I didn't know how he was going to react. But a week later, he walked over to my office and handed me a $25,000 check.
Amen.
And he said, thank you for opening my eyes. And if I would have backed down to him, one, he would have never become a supporter, and two, he would still be blind to the things around him. And I think we do. I think what David said about making holy trouble, I may try that, the holy stuff, because I haven't, you know. But
make sure it's holy.
I've just been doing trouble, but I think you have to challenge our folks. I look at another passage I like is Luke 22:52 when Jesus was being arrested, and he was being arrested, you know, the religious people kind of set him up. And he said to them, and I like it, it's in the New Living Translation. He says, you come to me as if I'm a revolutionary. Mm-hmm. See, I, not knocking what Mike Slaughter calls Jesus a rebel, but I really don't like calling him a rebel, but I do like calling him a revolutionary. He said, "You come to me like I'm a revolutionary." And it was the religious people who arrested him, who had, you know, who was undermining his thing. And sometimes, you know, they're going to get upset, but I still think you have to stand your ground. Don't be mean. I'm trying that more in my life, not to be mean now, but you've got to hold to what the word says. And I think that's one of the things I learned from Dietrich Bonhoeffer is you've got to let the word of God be the word of God. And if this is what it calls us to, we got to challenge our people to do it, to find who it is that's an outcast in your community and go minister to them.
Amen.
And because there's outcasts in every community. I don't care where you live. I've lived from the rural dairy farms to downtown Chattanooga. There's outcasts in every community. And you just got to challenge your people in a loving way, you know, because Jesus was loving. You got to challenge your people in a loving way to see the outcasts and then to minister to them.
Because it is about being bold and and courageous and giving leadership to that. Will, you have one last thing you want to say?
One thing that has occurred with the ministry that I'm a part of is that people all of a sudden from all denominations, not only United Methodist, but from all over the community have said we were not aware of the extent of kind of like the gentleman, they didn't know. We got a lot of publicity. The newspaper gave us some really front page coverage that we could have never afforded to pay for. But through that, we had, I think, every denomination plus independent people came. And they said, thank you for opening our eyes and helping us to see that there is a need beyond ourselves. And we need to get involved in that. So it's really opened their eyes.
Yeah. Friends, let's stand, if you will. I'd like for you to extend your hand. Oh God, as we reach our hands upward, Lord, we want to come alongside one another. Because sometimes we walk this journey just like Jesus and the disciples did. And it was lonely. It was hard. It was difficult. And Jesus went to a Roman cross for the forgiveness of our sin. And then we have people that say, it's too cold this morning to go to church. God, help us. Help us to be that all that you have called us to be. The journey's not easy. But Lord, what a blessing. When I hear a young man say, thank you for treating us like people. And then I see people that nobody else would have allowed them to share in worship and to sing a song. And the voice wasn't too wonderful. It wouldn't have made the voice, but Lord, in that moment, it was beautiful because it was anointed by your Holy Spirit. So God, there's a whole world out here. There are neighbors, there are family that need your love and touch. As we reach out to you, Lord, lead us, guide us, and direct us. And we're looking forward to what you're going to do in and through us and others this day and this week. In the name of Jesus, amen.
Amen.
Thank you all very much.
No, right?